Okay.
Thank you. Did you get them?
If you take a look at the second page. Now, I kind of do a classroom-style presentation, but if you're just talking to somebody about the issue of abortion, I've learned that there are certain things you might want to keep in mind as you're talking to people. So you want to be effective in your defense of life, and you want to try to balance two things. One is that you have a really strong conviction that life is precious and that all human life should be protected. Right, so that's one thing. The other thing is, with the number of abortions that have taken place in the United States, you never know who you're talking to. It might be someone who has had an abortion. It might be someone who has a friend who has had an abortion. So you're going to have to try to balance two things. One is your conviction that life is precious, but also understanding that life is messy and people sometimes make terrible mistakes. So you're going to try to balance those two things. So where it says some things to think about. When discussing abortion with friends, again, remember it's likely they may know someone who's had an abortion. Be firm in your beliefs, but show concern for those who have made such a tragic mistake or who may be experiencing a pregnancy that they hadn't expected. Right, so yeah, a little bit of sensitivity. Offer to connect people with resources. How many people know what Project Rachel is? What is Project Rachel?
It's a ministry in Boston to help women after an abortion.
Yes. It's run by the Catholic Church, but they will serve anyone. But if someone you know has had an abortion and they're feeling awful about it and need to talk about it and find forgiveness, Project Rachel, you can find them online, is a ministry that will do that. And the church also runs a ministry called Pregnancy Help. So you want to plug people in with services if you bump into someone who's having a particular issue. Explain some of the after effects. I'll talk a little bit about this. The after effects of abortion on both women and men. And how many people have a story that they can share of somebody who they know that perhaps has made a mistake? Because I have several. I have people in my life. Stories sometimes can be very educational as long as you protect people's privacy. You don't want to name people in a story. Sometimes one of the things that gets overlooked is the pain that abortion can cause for men. I met a man many years ago who was involved with the pro-life movement. And I always want to know, how did you get involved with this, right? I'm always curious and a little bit nosy, so I wanted to know, how did you get involved with this? But he told me a very sad story of 25 years earlier. He and his girlfriend conceived a child. He pressured her into an abortion, and she was devastated afterwards. And he picked up a drinking habit because of it, because of what it did to his girlfriend and the loss of the child. So sometimes, you know, it's not just women, but sometimes it's men who are going to experience this sort of thing. Advocate for adoption. That's one option that I don't think gets enough attention. It's not the solution to everyone, but it can be a very loving choice. Does anybody here know what an open adoption is? Open adoption? Exactly. If the birth mother and the adopting family agrees, they can maintain contact with each other. For some people, that's a solution. You know, different things work for different people. The next point I find is absolutely key. In all the years that I've spoken to young people, use pictures of unborn children, and again, try to pick up a sense of who you're talking to before you do this. Use pictures of unborn children to make your case for defending an unborn child. Ask the person you are discussing this with if they've ever seen an ultrasound. How many of us, everybody seen an ultrasound? Everybody seen an ultrasound, right? And that's one very powerful, even if you don't have a picture on you, you know, you don't have a picture of an unborn child, simply ask people, have you ever seen an ultrasound? And what do you see when you look at that image? And in parentheses, I put something that I think is very important. At least when you first begin talking to people, avoid using graphic pictures. Pictures of children who have been aborted. When you're first talking to people, you don't want to shock them and chase them away, and that's what it does. You want to begin, when I when I was working my way through, how am I going to teach this, I asked myself this question. Do I want to show people that abortion is awful, or do I want to show people that life is beautiful? And I think, I mean, there's a time when you can show these pictures, but I don't recommend it, especially when you're talking to people who you don't know what their background is. Using graphic pictures is kind of the last resort, if nothing else works. Use the evidence of science. I'm a science teacher. I got to be pro-life before I was ever a religious person. Because sometimes I tell people kind of funny, just a story. When I was about 3 years old, I was having an argument with my sister, who was 4 years old, and she was giving me a really hard time. You know, I was born in Florida, I flew in a pet plane, and you never did. So she was giving me this hard time about how experienced woman of the world my four-year-old sister. Well, I was kind of upset about this, and my mother was pregnant with my brother Mike at the time. So I went into the kitchen, and I said to my mother, when you flew in the plane from Florida, was I in your belly the way that the baby is now? And she said, yes. So I told my sister, I flew in a plane too. I was in mom, and mom was in the plane. Sometimes the simplest things, you know, can be compelling. But to me, whether you're a religious person or not, this is a human story. This is how we all come to be. However, if you are talking to a religious person, certainly you can use scripture and religious arguments. But the important thing is to get a feel for who you're talking to a little bit. Share stories of people you know who have given life to a child in spite of different difficult circumstances. Many people underestimate the strength of women who have been in dire circumstances and chose life. Those are important stories to tell. And then encourage membership in a pro-life organization, such as us, NASA Citizens of Life. The website's down below. Afterabortion.org is a very valuable website because a lot of times people do not understand how devastating an abortion experience can be for a woman. And they have all the data. I'll give you some of that, you know, later. If you're into history and law, this nice website called endpro.org, which is very good, and Pregnancy Help Boston. So those are kind of valuable websites. But just a little background, and then I'll show you the kind of program that I do. Hopefully you'll invite me to your local group or church or whatever, and I'll come to you and talk to your folks. I'm not a lawyer, but when I decided I was going to do this work, I said, you know what, Linda, you're going to have to read Roe versus Wade, the decision from the Supreme Court. You got to read it, right? So I, pardon the pun, I waded through all that legal language. And something jumped out at me right away. And that's what's in italics up at the top of the page. Next page. We need not resolve the difficult question of when life begins. What's wrong with that sentence? If you're going to say that it's okay to have an abortion, what is the first thing you make sure it doesn't do? What do you need to know? If you look at the two bullet points, you have to know, is it a life, right? Is it a life? If you look at the two bullet points, the very first thing the Supreme Court should have done is to answer the question, when does life begin, right? Is this a life? You know, and I'm a science person, right? I know when life begins. How many of you have high school biology? We all have high school biology. You look at any biology textbook, and it's going to tell you when life begins. It's not a difficult question. And do you know when scientists discovered fertilization? 1829. So we've known for a very long time when life begins. Now, I'm a science person, so what I'm going to give you here, anybody that says to you, we don't know when a human life begins, starting in 1962, how many people know who, do anybody know who Isaac Asimov is? Anybody like science fiction? Very famous science fiction writer, right? But I want you to look, I went back as far as 1962. You could probably go back even further. But I want you to look at all the medical textbooks, that tell you, you know, 1963, 1964, 1965. A human being originates in the union of two gametes, which are sex cells, right? So science is unequivocal in this. Science is, there's no question about when a human life begins. So if you go to the third page, so again, you're in college, you have to write a term paper defending the right to life. I'm going to give you some, you know, some quotes that you can use. But if you look in the middle of the page, well, people are going to say, well, it isn't a person. It can't take care of itself. It can't do calculus, you know. And when they say that, what they really, what your answer to that is, it's a human being, but it's very immature. Right? We start out as human beings, right from the very beginning. How many of you have studied fertilization in a science class? Studied fertilization in a science class? Right. You take that egg cell, this is how human we are, even as an egg cell. If you take that egg cell and you try to connect it with a sperm cell, a male cell from a different non-human being, it cannot enter. That's how human the chemistry is, right at the very beginning. We're human and we're alive. Look at the definition of a person. Does it say anything about how mature it is? DNA makes us human, right? And embryo is a living, this is all right out of the dictionary. I could have gone to the Supreme Court and said, go to the dictionary and you'll find out when a human life begins, right? Fetus is an unborn vertebrate, pregnant means containing unborn, and so on. And then some people will try to tell you, I'm not a legal person, but I did pick up a few legal arguments along the line. If you look at where it says legal personhood, as far back as 1795, an unborn child had the right to inherit property. Yeah, so if you're into law, unborn children were entitled to all the privileges of other persons, and so forth. So this is kind of background material for some of the more basic introductory arguments on behalf of defending life for the womb. If anybody has any questions about any of this. All right, so what I'm going to do now is kind of go through the type of presentation that I do. Later on, you're in some program and you're looking for speakers. We're trying to train other speakers. If you want to do what I do, hopefully you'll be a speaker down the road. But I'd like to show you what a talk might look like. So basically, I do three things. I like to explain how I got to be pro-life, the harmful effects of abortion on women, and then the facts of development. So I got to be a pro-life person a really long time ago, around 1968. How many people know when abortion became legal? When did abortion become legal? Who haven't heard? 1973, but I got to be pro-life around 1968 because all those years ago I was a junior in college and I was getting a teaching degree in biology. That's what I did for a living. I taught science for 34 years in the Boston Public Schools. But I always remember this one particular day in my life when I was a junior in college because this one day split my life. This one day changed everything about me forever. I have never been the same. Because on this one particular day, my professor took us downstairs from the laboratory and into the auditorium, and he showed us this little film called The First Days of Life. And it was a very, very beautiful film for the time that it was made. In that film, they had actual pictures of the moment of conception, when those two sex cells from the father and the mother joined to start a brand new life. They had motion pictures of the different stages of embryological development and fetal development, and then they showed the birth of a beautiful baby at the end of the film. And I share this with people because it is a true story about me, even though I'm not always very proud of this. But back in 1968, I happened to be a Catholic, but I wasn't a practicing Catholic. In 1968, I doubt if you could have called me a Christian. I didn't even know if I believed in God way back in the 60s, you know? I was young, the 60s were kind of crazy, right? But I do have to tell everyone who will listen the truth about that moment, that movie, and that day in my life, because it absolutely changed me forever. When I came out of that auditorium after seeing those pictures of those little children who'd been inside of their mothers waiting to be born, I knew, I absolutely knew, that I had just seen the first and the most beautiful miracle of my entire life. I was absolutely blown away how you and I and every other human, we start our life as a single cell. How many of us have studied cells in science? Cells? Yeah, we start our life as a single cell. We're a speck. We're about as big as a pencil dot. And then look what happens. We become the beautiful creatures that God meant for us to be. So I've been a pro-life person for a really long time, but in the beginning it wasn't because I was religious. I got to be pro-life because I had studied modern biology. So that in 1973, when the U.S. Supreme Court made abortion legal, I was upset and I was really angry, but not as a religious person. I was upset because I was a science teacher. You know, I just spent a lot of time and money getting my degree. My teacher showed me when a human life began. They showed me what a baby looked like before it was born, and I couldn't believe that there were 7 educated men on the Supreme Court. I couldn't believe that they were actually trying to tell people that they didn't know if a woman carried a baby for 9 months, a baby that deserved the protection of the law. I couldn't believe that. And so, about 36 years ago, I decided that I would give up some time and I would go out and speak to people about this. And I've given my time up basically for 2 reasons. One of them, and I've kind of shared already, I have at least 20 people in my life. These are people that I still love and still care about, but they've actually gone through an abortion experience. And I know what it did, you know, in their life. And I really believe this, that abortion is not only anti-child, but abortion is incredibly anti-woman. Abortion hurts women in at least 2 ways. First of all, it's the woman's body that is invaded by this surgery, this procedure. It's the woman's body that can be damaged or infected, so that later on, when she perhaps feels more prepared to have a baby, do you know that if she has had an abortion, she has increased her risk of miscarriage, of having a premature baby, of suffering labor difficulties? She's at higher risk for something called an ectopic pregnancy. That's where the baby develops in the wrong place. And in a very small percentage of cases, there are a few women, just a few, but if they've had an abortion, they're not even able to have children again. And so one of the reasons that I'm against abortion is because it hurts women physically. But abortion can also hurt a woman emotionally and spiritually. And I have to tell people, I saw this happen to someone. When I started teaching in Boston a long time ago, I shared an apartment with a friend. And one night, my friend had gone to bed. I was in the front room watching television, minding my own business. But I happened to overhear my friend talking in her sleep. And in her sleep, she kept repeating the name Jeffrey, which is not unusual. Except that my friend was engaged to marry my brother Michael. And so I wondered, you know, why are you dreaming about Jeffrey if you're going to marry somebody else? And so the next morning, when we had breakfast, I said to her, I'm not trying to be nosy, even though it was, you know, but who's Jeffrey? I overheard you talking in your sleep. And she told me a story that I will always remember because it is so very, very sad. Jeffrey was the name of a baby that she had aborted about 6 years before this dream. 6 years later, that baby was still part of her life because here she was dreaming about this baby and calling out for her child in her sleep, you know. And I've never forgotten that. You know, once that baby is gone, you know, there's nothing that you can do, you know, to bring that life back. I always remember she told me, if one person and only one person had stood by me, I never would have done it. She would have found a different way, you know, to deal with her pregnancy. So, you know, sometimes you might hear people say this, I know someone they had an abortion, doesn't bother them. I always have to add very sadly that it doesn't bother them yet. Because my friend told me that for the first, you know, 3 or 4 years or so after she did this, it wasn't a problem. It wasn't until she got a little bit older, she met somebody new, she fell in love, she got engaged to be married, and maybe getting ready to become pregnant again, and all those memories of her first baby came rushing back. A woman is a mother forever, even if a baby that's gone. So one of the reasons I feel very strongly about this is that abortion can hurt a woman, you know, physically and emotionally and spiritually. Sometimes we forget, too, that abortion can be a painful experience for a man. I have met some men, some fathers, who were secretly heartbroken when their girlfriends or their wives went ahead and aborted a baby that the father secretly wanted. A man cannot protect his child, and it's his child too. Am I wrong? Two people, opposite sex, still make a baby. Am I right about that? You know? Two people help to make every baby, but one person, the father, is treated as a second-class citizen. And they go through the rest of their lives wondering, I wonder what my little girl would have been like. I wonder what we would have named our son. And so I'm convinced in the end that abortion hurts everybody. I have two other reasons that I'd like to share with you, and then I would like to show you some beautiful pictures of fetal development, and then perhaps take questions. One of the reasons that I'm against abortion is because it's kind of a lie. I'm assuming most of us have a Christian background here, am I right? What's the commandment that tells us we have to be truthful? How does it go? Haven't heard from this table. Somebody tell me. Which commandment? You shall not bear false
witness.
Yeah. You gotta tell the truth. Now, if you've ever had a lesson on truth telling, which I think is important, right? One of the things I like to share with people is that there's two kinds of lies, right? One kind of lie, somebody tells you something false, right? One kind of lie. The other kind of lie, though, I think is really kind of tricky. It's a lie when somebody doesn't tell you something that you need to know. They only tell you half the truth, right? How many people have ever been lied to that way? Somebody only told you half the story. Anybody ever been lied to that way? And I think that's what's going on with abortion. And I like to show people a copy of something that I think is kind of a lie. I don't know if you can see this down the back, but this is an enlargement of an ad that was in the Boston Globe a very long time ago. But it was placed in the Globe by Preterm, which was a very busy abortion clinic, you know, in Brookline, the other side of Boston. And the people who worked here, thousands of abortions every year. And at a couple hundred dollars a piece, pretty hefty amount of money came through the doors of this clinic. But I want to share with you what the ad says. And then I'd like to show you what this ad hides, what it leaves out, and why I really think that this ad is terribly dishonest and places to stay away from. What the ad says is this: Preterm is announcing another service, and then underneath that it says second trimester abortion. A trimester is 3 months. So what they're talking about in this ad, what they're calling a service, is doing an abortion during the fourth, the fifth, possibly the sixth month of pregnancy. Do you know this? Do you know that abortion is legal in the United States through all 9 months of pregnancy? All 9 months of pregnancy, right up to the day of birth, if you can find a doctor who's willing to do it. But I really don't want there to be any doubt in your mind as to what this ad means. I don't think this ad is completely honest. And so, because I'm a science teacher, I can get this out, I bring this with me wherever I go. This was given to me through a doctor friend a long time ago when I told him what I was trying to do. What my doctor friend gave to me was this. Now, what I have in my hand, this is an exact medical model. This is a doctor's model of a second trimester unborn baby. This, what I have in my hand, This is exactly what they are talking about in this ad. This is what the people who work in this clinic, and this was, is what they will destroy, you know, for what, $100, $200, whatever dollars, and call it a service. This is what Planned Parenthood, the National Organization for Women and Preterm, and all of the political folks who believe in reproductive, you know, it's interesting in politics, they don't call it abortion usually. They call it reproductive rights, but that's what they're talking about. This is what they're trying to tell you isn't a baby. This is what they want you to think is just a little piece of tissue. And I'm sure your eyes must see the same as mine do, because this really is a very small woman. It's a very small baby. And all of us used to look something like this baby. How many people here tonight within the last year or two, young people particularly, how many of you have been to the doctors? Maybe you had a sports physical or a flu shot or something like that. Do you ever notice that when you go to the doctors, doctors have a language all their own? How many of us want to go into medicine? Doctors, nurses, therapists, okay. Doctors have a language all their own. If you're playing soccer, any soccer folks here? Soccer? Soccer? Okay. Football, hockey. When I went to Hingham once, they all played hockey. Softball? Any girls play softball? If you play sports and you hurt your head, when you go to the doctor, your doctor doesn't write a report about your head. Your doctor talks about, what's the technical term for your, and how many people know the word cranium? Cranium? Cranium. Right? If you dislocate your shoulder, your doctor doesn't write about your shoulder. Your doctor writes about this bone called the, I do my biology lesson here, the humerus, right? All the muscles that hold your shoulder in place. If you crack your knee, your doctor's not going to write about your knee. Your doctor writes about a small bone called the patella. Doctors have a language all their own. Now, I wonder if I could see by show of hands, right? How many people know the technical word that a doctor uses to discuss a baby in the womb? What does a doctor call a baby in the womb? How many of us have at least heard the word fetus? We all have heard the word fetus. Okay. I wonder if I can find somebody here tonight who can tell me two things about the word fetus. Where does the word fetus come from? What language? And second, what does it mean in that language? This is my quiet table, so I'm going to pick on you for a minute. Where does the word fetus come from?
Latin.
It's a Latin word. Do you know what it means in Latin?
Baby.
Close. In Latin, the word fetus means? What is it? That's real close, and some books will define it that way. I'm looking for another word. Close. Close.
Premature.
All right. I always make this kind of interesting. Let me see if I still got it here. Let's see if we can figure it out. No Google searches. Right? What does the word fetus mean in Latin? All right, I'll give you a hint. I'll take the first hand that I see, all right? All right? The exact meaning of the word fetus in Latin begins with the letter O. We'll have a little Jeopardy music in the background. Anybody?
Ovary?
Reasonable, but no. Okay. If you ever are on Jeopardy, go ahead. No, that's a good guess, too.
Orion?
No, these are all reasonable. All right. If you ever are on Jeopardy, you will now know that in Latin, the word fetus means offspring. Offspring. Because a baby, no matter what you call it, is still a baby. Who told me young one, though? That's the second definition in the dictionary. What's your name? I'm sorry?
I thought you were
going to say Anthony. No, you give it up for Anthony, right? Alright, it means offspring, you know, because a baby, no matter what you call it, is still a baby. Now, please don't tell anybody what I'm about to tell you. I'm almost 70 years old. Whenever any of my friends got pregnant, nobody ever picked up the phone, really excited, and said to me, Linda, guess what? I'm going to have a little fetus. Nobody says that. right? Think about this. My friends have really left me out, right? Whenever any of my friends got pregnant, I have yet to be invited to a fetus shower. I've always been invited to a baby shower. Because what's really sad about this issue is if people are happy about the pregnancy, what do they call it? A baby. If there's a problem, they switch the name to fetus and they pretend that it's something else. But a baby, no matter what you call it, is still a baby. So all of this, you might have noticed so far, have I done a lot of talk about religion? Have I done a lot of talk about religion? No. Do you think a person has to be religious to think that abortion is a bad idea? No. How many of us, just so that I know who I'm talking, I like to know my audience. Most of us have Christian background? Most of us? Okay. Can anybody tell me which one of the Ten Commandments might be involved with this issue? Over here.
The Fifth Commandment.
All right, the Fifth Commandment, you shall not kill. And, you know, I always wonder, what does God think about abortion? And I think God makes, God is very saddened by an abortion. Because the God that I believe in is a loving God. And he loves every baby that's ever made, right? And I don't know how we think we can do this, you know, to a child of God. I'm also a biology person, and I talk to people about the environment. What's that? Environment. I have to talk to the schools you go to about a little MCAS here, right? Environment is your surroundings, right? I also, you've heard of the endangered species, though, right? We all okay on that? Okay. If I, years ago, were to take a camping trip out to Yellowstone Park and I happened to find an eagle's egg with a little baby bird inside that shell, do you know that if I took an eagle's egg and I dropped it on the ground so that the shell cracked and the little bird inside died, what would happen to me? What would have happened to me? I'd have been arrested, taken to court, fined $5,000, put me in jail for a year. Why? For destroying a fetal bird before it was born. Is that right? That bird's valuable to us. So we protect it even before it's born out of the shell through every stage to the end. And yet in the same country, we pretend that we don't know when the lives of our children begin. And you can do horrible things to a baby in the womb and there's no penalty at all. And I have a hard time with that. So that's sort of the first religious thing. One more religious thing, and then I will show you the science. A long time ago, I was doing this program, and a young person wanted to know how an abortion is done. And I'm not going to get into that sort of thing tonight, but I answered the question that night. And I wanted the young people to see what I was talking about, so I went back to being a biology teacher, and I decided that I would show them this. This also was a gift through my doctor friend. This is a medical model of the uterus or womb. This is the part of the mom's body where the baby grows and develops for 9 months. And this is about halfway through the pregnancy. When a woman isn't pregnant, her womb is much smaller. It's probably even smaller than this. But when the baby grows, you know, the womb gets larger too to keep up with the size of her child. So on this one particular night, I stood in front of a room full of, I think they were eighth graders, and I held up the model of the womb, and I began to describe how an abortion is done. And I had the model of the womb in one hand, and I had the model of the little baby in the other. And all of a sudden, as I was explaining this, I realized something. You know, I don't know how many times I have prayed the scriptures, you know, about Mary and visiting Elizabeth. For the Catholics, it would be the Hail Mary. How many times have I said, "Blessed is the fruit of thy womb"? Isn't that exactly what that prayer, or that scripture verse means? They're talking about the child Jesus, who became just like us in every way, except sin. Jesus spent 9 months as a tiny baby inside the womb of Mary, and then he was born, you know, just like everyone.